Good afternoon, barcoders. Put your hand up at the back if you can't hear me. Don't believe you, Alex. So it's my pleasure to introduce the final plenary session of this wonderful conference. And I'm going to start off with some personal observations of the state of barcoding these days. So we really have come a very long way. From humble beginnings, if anything published in a Royal Society journal could be considered humble, we've really increased the number of publications using barcoding over time. This shows the situation some 6-7 years ago. In 2006, the critics of barcoding published more papers than the people that supported it. So the question is the microscope mightier than the barcode laser saber? And the answer is clearly no. The column on the right shows the number of papers published in 2014 in green, supportive of barcoding in red. If you can see it shrunk in the bottom right-hand corner, the number of papers that seem to be critical of DNA barcoding. So this seems to be continued aggression from a small minority of people. Now, this picture is modified from Monty Python's Search for the Holy Grail. And if you remember this segment in the movie, what's going on is that Arthur is trying to get across a small bridge, and which is being defended by the Dark Knight. And the Dark Knight is very stubborn and overconfident. They get into a short fight, upon which almost immediately the Dark Knight loses one arm. He doesn't give up, he keeps attacking and loses another arm. Arthur gets down to pray for safe deliverance. The Dark Knight comes up and kicks him. Arthur chops off a leg. Then the other leg. Arthur runs away. Well, not runs away, he leaves, he doesn't need to run away. And the Dark Knight says, "Come back, you coward, I'll bite your legs off." So the question is, why are the people that are critical of the DNA barcoding enterprise keep on at it when it seems fairly clear what the results are? Well, let's consider this. How many citations would a paper entitled "A New Species of Entomobride Colembolin from Nebraska" get? Compare that to the number of citations of a paper that says, the title of which is "Five More Reasons Why DNA Barcoding is a Pile of Dingo's Kidneys." So what I've done is to look at the citations to DNA barcoding attacks and original taxonomic research from three of the critics. In blue, the barcoding attacks. In orange, the original taxonomic papers. So it's clear, if you want to get your work cited, you attack DNA barcoding rather than actually doing some original taxonomy. Of course, this also works for people that are proponents of DNA barcoding, but I've analyzed the next bit of data in a slightly different way. Here what I've done is to calculate the H-index just for original taxonomic articles by three detractors and three supporters of DNA barcoding, randomly chosen. And the H-index for the supporters of DNA barcoding is greater than that for the people that attack DNA barcoding. This kind of suggests to me that maybe people that are open-minded enough to accept a new method into their research are likely to be doing better work in the first place. Maybe, maybe not. Nonetheless, I think the foes of DNA barcoding have been vanquished. So, obviously that was a very perfunctory analysis of the data, but if there's any young taxonomists out there that want to get a great H-index and many citations, you could analyze the data, kind of data I presented, properly and write a decent article, it would be fairly straightforward. Okay, now on to the real task of the afternoon. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce Thomas Lovejoy. He is a senior fellow at the United Nations Foundation, and he's well known in conservation biology worldwide. One of the reasons for this, he first coined the term biological diversity. He developed the Depth for Nature swap programs and led the Minimum Critical Size of Ecosystems project. For us in Canada, he is to be thanked for chairing the Canadian Council of Academies report on the state of biodiversity science in Canada. His talk is entitled Exploring Life on Earth, a Grand and Critical Adventure. Please join me in welcoming Thomas Lovejoy.
When your career, like Dan's and mine, covers a bit of sweep of history, it is, in fact, quite wonderful from a science perspective to experience personally how technology has advanced. And at the cusp of that is the barcode of life, for which we can thank Officer Paul Hébert of the Order of Canada, as his own country has honored him. Thank you, Paul. The idea of exploring unknown life on Earth has long been a grand challenge. As the great intellectual of the United States Senate, Daniel Patrick Moynihan, once said of it, well, that's a big idea. And it dwarfs sending a probe to learn about the surface of Pluto. It dwarfs it in complexity, it dwarfs it in importance, because, after all, it is about the living planet, which is our home. And we had abundant evidence throughout this conference of exciting new discoveries and insights from the genetic, how American eels actually can adapt and simultaneously be panmictic, all the way to the biome. The irony of organic evolution, as Ed Wilson pointed out, is that just as it has displayed and developed the capacity to understand itself, it is actively, busily engaged in erasing the evidence. So, a planetary biodiversity mission, however constituted, however executed, is but common sense. As per Aldo Leopold's admonition that the first law of intelligent tinkering is to save all the pieces. Yet it is more than that, much more than that. Especially as we enter the few decades when exponential environmental change can no longer be mistaken for linear environmental change. Current forecasts are for an increase of 4 billion people to bring the global total to around 11 billion. And all this is going on at a time when great global cycles are distorted by human activity. I expect all of you are familiar with the Planetary Boundaries paper in Nature in 2009 and recently revised. Some colleagues object that they're not real boundaries. And the ecologically naive, to put it nicely, deliberate or otherwise, object because they would just basically reject the notion of limits of any sort. But the reality is, these are the boundaries of the conditions which nourished the rise of human civilization. And it is folly to ignore them. In the boundaries diagram, the nitrogen excursion beyond its boundary is pretty accurate. That's because there are twice the normal levels of biologically active nitrogen in the world. Climate change, that excursion, I believe, in fact, is underestimated. And I've had that discussion with Johan Rockström, and he agrees. It's underestimated because of the impacts of climate change on biodiversity. And the biodiversity excursion exceeds its boundary by far the most of them all. And why? It's pretty simple, actually. It's because nothing is considered an environmental problem unless it affects living systems. So what that means is biodiversity integrates all environmental problems. So conserving biodiversity means you actually have to solve all environmental problems, not just deal with direct impacts on biodiversity. Almost 70 years ago, Ruth Patrick demonstrated this when she showed that the number and kind of species in a stream or river reflect not only its natural physics, as well as its natural geology, natural chemistry, and natural biology, but that it also reflects the stresses put on the watershed by human activity. So when you think about it through that lens, planetary boundaries are but the Patrick principle writ large at the level of the entire biosphere. So the barcode of life enables us to measure and monitor environmental health from the level of the organism all the way to that of the biosphere. A very powerful tool, just as we need it critically. It also enables us to take advantage of the way evolution is constantly innovating, constantly exploring, constantly testing, constantly devising new solutions to biological problems. Recently, a soil fungus in Nova Scotia was discovered to have the ability to block the mechanism that superbacteria, superbugs, use to block antibiotic activity. I mean, that is an incredibly powerful discovery with huge implications for human health. And I would consider it another gilded maple leaf Canada can add to its cap along with the barcode of life. So biodiversity is essentially, when viewed this way, a gigantic library for the life sciences, any page of which can revolutionize human and planetary welfare. And the barcode of life is the index to that library. We are all scientists, but as Dylan Ripley once said, any biologist with a conscience should spend time on conservation. There are, of course, many ways to do that, as many as would suit any one person's lifestyle. Even if it's only in its most selfish form, because it conserves the living things we like to study. I really believe that as scientists, we have to be engaged as we never have before. For too long, the forces of destruction, if I may refer to them that way, whatever their real intentions, for too long, those forces have defined their ambitions as reasonable, implying that those of conservation are not reasonable. I believe the time has come to redefine what is reasonable, and that the biologists have to be the ones that do that. So, a couple examples of the kinds of challenges we face in the decades ahead. In Africa, south of the Sahara, less than 30% of intact savanna remains. Good scientists have actually shown that the coming 2 billion additional Africans actually can be fed without destroying another square meter of nature in Africa. The issue is how to make that happen, how to get a little bit of a handle on the disorderly processes of human economic development. International climate negotiators agreed upon a limit of 2 degrees, no more than 2 degrees of global warming, without any sense of whether it had intrinsic merit or not. It was basically because they thought it might be doable. Now they're worried that it's not doable. The state of coral reefs and of coniferous forests with bark beetle dieback in Western North America tell us that that number is wrong, that 2 degrees is too much. As biologists, we actually know, if we stop and think about it, that there is so much excess CO2 in the atmosphere that comes from the destruction of modern-day ecosystems, as opposed to the ancient ones of fossil fuels, that there is a lot, maybe even half a degree of CO2 that could be pulled from the atmosphere before it generates that climate change by doing ecosystem restoration at scale. Again, the issue is how to make that happen, how to guide human economic development to a happier landing. So I believe it is time for biologists to take center stage, and that the barcode of life greatly magnifies our capacity to do it and to do it well, especially as long as we heed Nancy Knowlton's caution not to let the excellent get in the way of the good. We are frequently asked, and I'd be willing to bet everybody here has been asked this question at some point about a species, like, what good is it? What good is that? I find it a profoundly irritating question, which, you know, I'd like to use as a rejoinder, well, what good are you, right? But it's, you know, it's hard to answer when you don't really even know the species or a lot about its biology. So recently I was in Northern Territory in Australia, and I had a wonderful morning wandering around on a 1.5 billion year old seafloor with ripples, the old ripples from the ancient ocean in it, and it was strewn with stromatolites. Well, one might ask, what use is a stromatolite? Especially as they are made up of fossil blue-green organisms not doing anything more than just being fossils. Yes, we can, in a sense, be grateful for their having enabled the rise of higher life, if we want to call it that, by raising atmospheric oxygen levels. But they're mostly gone, and we have the oxygen we need. The lesson of the stromatolites is that they basically made themselves marginal by filling the atmosphere with their toxic wastes, which happen to be oxygen. And yet, we are doing exactly the same thing with carbon dioxide. So the lesson of the stromatolites shows us what not to do. And the barcode of life has come in the nick of time to help us care for our wonderfully biodiverse living planet. Thank you.
Okay, so Tom is willing to take questions if anybody has any. We're all, okay, yes, Peter.
I've got a microphone now. I attended a very interesting lecture while I was in Brazil called Is Ecology a Subversive Science? I believe that came from a paper written in 1964 in Bioscience. I'm consulting my notes as I'm going along. And I wonder if you think that ecology is still a subversive science, or is it something more important than just a subversive science at this point?
So I think you probably could gather from what I said that I don't think it's a subversive science. It is, in fact, the science that we need to pay a hell of a lot of attention to. Otherwise, we'll end up, you know, sort of lurking around the edges of Kangaroo Island like the stromatolites.
So our next speaker is Professor Dan Janzen. He is a professor of conservation biology at the University of Pennsylvania, well known with his co-architect Winnie Halwax for the Area de Conservación Guanacaste in Costa Rica. He's also well known as the conservation biologist and an early supporter of barcoding and the winner of numerous awards. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Dan Janzen to you. Please welcome him to the stage.
Yes, please.
Can you keep your lights?
It's night. We're sitting in front of a campfire 9,000 years ago. Your genes say that some of you are 4, 5, 6 years old, listening to me tell a story, filling your databases. Some of you are 15, 16, 17, thinking about going on the same voyage. And some of you have got gray hair like I do, and thinking about whether it's wise or not wise to let those teenagers go on that voyage. What I am is a hunter, and what Winnie is a hunter. Now, we have just come back from a long trip. Over the top of that ridge, looking at the next valley, see if there's anybody there, think about, might our village move to that village or to that area? We're hunter-gatherers. It's very tempting to riff on what I've just spent a week listening to other hunter-gatherers tell about what they found when they went on their trip. But I'm going to attempt to stay on cue. This starts in 1960. Polly Bear jumped out of that chair, sitting in a classroom somewhere, and startled the teacher by going and getting that moth from inside the window here in Canada. This is the same moth in front of my house in Costa Rica. I took this picture in 1953 when I was 1 year difference in age to Paul, when he found that moth. We're killers. We're hunter-gatherers. That's my father. That's my shotgun. Actually, his. This is me at that time. And that's me with a butterfly nut there. But it's in Mexico. Now, why was I in Mexico in ninth grade? This museum, it's obviously Victorian, had a public library here on these two floors and a natural history museum on this floor. And I lived in that OpenStax library, downtown Minneapolis. And one day the curators in that natural history museum put a frame up on the wall with a bunch of beautiful butterflies in it. And I said, wow, where are those from? And he said, South America. I didn't even know what South America was. So I went home, and right at that same time, my father said to me, I've got 2 months of federal leave, and if I don't take it, I'll lose it. What do we do? I said, well, let's go to Mexico and collect butterflies. So they took me out of school. We spent 2 months driving all over Mexico in 1953 collecting butterflies. That's my butterfly collection in the display window of a bank downtown Minneapolis. These are the butterflies. This is Smithsonian Institution. My father, excuse me, took me in there when I was 10 years old. And a person showed me this drawer of beetles a few meters from where the Costa Rican inventory of butterflies is residing today in the Smithsonian. But what I noticed wasn't so much the drawer, but the labels. I was fascinated by the fact that Well, along with the insect came a little package of information. So really what I'm talking about today is this question. How do we conserve tropical wildlands? Basically, through that. And what I've heard all week long is that. But I'm going to talk about a Costa Rican example. In addition to being hunters and gatherers, we are in fact developers of tropical real estate. We build tropical shopping malls. That's really what we do. And these are our shareholders. Now, the particular shopping mall that Winnie and I build, it's got 375,000 shareholders. And our goal is that that shopping mall is still there forever. And this is an interview of a shareholder. A school teacher sent me this, very proud of the fact that her fifth graders could know how to and handle that snake and show it to other people. That's what the photograph was sent to me for. That's not what I see in that photograph. What I see in the photograph is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cell phones. These are farm kids with a median family income of $3,000. This is another kind of client interview. We have the largest collection of five-legged butterflies and moths in the world. And that generates a blog, what you call a barcode. It's a paragraph about that fly. And an inventory is a big stack of those paragraphs, basically each one being a shareholder Facebook page. That right there is the barcode that leads to that shareholder's Facebook page, which contains this package of information. There's one of those for each one of these, but some of them also have a specimen attached, or a photograph attached, or an adult, or a piece of an adult over here. Now that's the president of Costa Rica, very proudly showing a plaque to his wife, the ministers, the director of the conservation area, government, at a meeting. But notice the name. That patronym is his. Now this wasp is all of 2 millimeters long, and he's very proud of it. That's connecting biodiversity to society. But we're used to doing that. You put patronyms on something for somebody who made a major donation. A president of a country makes a major donation. Of course he does. But what's this? This is the staff of the area that has those 375,000 species in it. And this is a paper just published. Every member of that staff is also a donor. And everyone has a patronym. Now to remind you, what we're doing is building a shopping mall. A shopping mall has permits. A shopping mall has architects. A park shopping mall has a guy who put the asphalt parking lot in front. A shopping mall has entrepreneurs. It has customers. It has repairmen. It has electricity bills. It has all those things. That's what a real national park is. Now where we work, this piece of real estate, right there, tiny little thing. It's the size of West Virginia when you put it on the United States. It's tiny. But if you count not acres, but biodiversity, it's that size. And in it, this conservation area, this specific project right there, it's the size of Toronto and its suburbs, contains 2.6% of the world's biodiversity. Because that little piece the size of West Virginia is 4% of the world's biodiversity. That's what it looks like on the ground, ocean, dry forest, cloud forest, rainforest. Classical map, this is what it looks like. It's taken 44 years to construct this shopping mall. It's cost $105 million. and this is the staff. And the front door has this sign. It's the only national park in the world that has the word development on its opening sign. Now in 1985, when we imagined this, like Paul in 2003, imagining barcoding, we were hardcore in the forest to hell with society biologists. Society didn't exist. And we were inside a national park for protection against society. That was us. We were just kids. But a very dramatic event occurred in 1985. This guy, the director of the National Park Service, is now dead, said, Dan, I got a problem. I got 1,500 gold miners in a national park in southern Costa Rica. Would you go down there and do an environmental impact statement for us? And as a favor to a friend, I said, well, yeah, sure. Well, this was the Corcovado that we knew. This is the park. Gorgeous, clean rivers, beautiful forest, big sawfish in the river. All the goodies, the stuff that's really nice in a national park. So we got there, we got off the plane, this is what we met. I looked at that, we had a week, we flew in to fly out, and I said, you know, I can do an environmental impact statement in 15 minutes. Everything's destroyed, full stop, end of report. So what do you do for a week? Well, we were hardcore field biologists. So what I do, okay, I'll study the gold miners, like they're animals in the forest. And I won't take the time here to recount the joy and the intrigue and the complexity of that study of the gold miners, but out of it came a realization. The only national park, the only conserved wildland in the world that's going to survive is one that is integrated with the society, that is financially secure, not a parasite, and that it's biologically big enough to tolerate the presence of human beings. That's it, folks. If it doesn't know the characteristics 100 years from now, it won't be here. And what's the point of saving something that won't be here 100 years from now? Now, in 1985, this guy, Rodrigo Gomez, professor at the University of Costa Rica, heard me give that as a preliminary thinking idea and talk. I.e., is the only solution I could see for how you'd have 1,500 gold miners not decide to go into a national park. Because they don't invade the hospital, they don't invade the university, they don't invade the highway system, they don't invade the telecommunication system. Why'd they invade the national park? Because it had no owner. It was set aside. No connection with society. So it's up for grabs. You see a $100 bill on the sidewalk, you pick it up. So he took me, he said, you know, the president ought to hear this. So he took me to Oscar Arias, who was the new president at that time. And he heard the story, and he only had one sentence to offer. He said, sounds good to me if it doesn't cost us anything. I said, I'm not asking for money, I'm asking for political permission. What we did unknowingly in 1985 was the equivalent of going to President Obama and saying, you know what? I want to take over Yellowstone and Gettysburg and run it my way. Would the US government say, oh, well, sure, that's a good idea. And especially if I'm from Burma. Okay. Well, then many interactions around that growth from then to now. Perhaps the best descriptor is this one right here. That's a label we suddenly found on the front of our squatter's house when we came back one day. Spanish, that's the Department of Meddling. We were a problem because we thought we knew how to run this place. And that's just plain meddling. But what did we have to do? Well, the first thing we had to do was buy a lot of land to make the thing a lot bigger, in order big enough so it could tolerate people doing things. Take Barro Colorado Island and ask yourself, how many soccer fields would you like to have there? How many would you put on Barro Colorado Island? Zero. If you've got 165,000 hectares, you can say, all right, where do you want your soccer field? Okay. Secondly, we had to do was stop the fires and let the organisms, the wind and the animals, bring the forest back. That's the grass pasture, the same photograph 20 years later after stopping the fire, and this is the reforestation agent right there. You'll see that blue jay and you think, oh, it's just a common bird, means nothing to conservation. Every time I see it, it's a flying teaspoonful of seeds. Okay. And you involve everybody. You don't go to school classrooms and lecture about conservation or about not putting beer cans in the river. You bring the kids to the place where the forest is that I grew up in, actually, and I feel very comfortable in. And you have them have their first girlfriend there, their first fight with somebody else there, their first argument with authority there, their first sleep out at night, the first time you get lost, the first time you're hungry, all those things that happen to you in grade school in the forest. Okay. This is what I call gardenification of nature. Now, what does that made-up word mean? It means that we have been protecting and fertilizing and planting and dealing with gardens for literally thousands of years. They're already in your genome. They're already in your sociological genome. And if we can have you think of a wild area as a garden instead of a set-aside, it's already, we've already won half the battle. So what comes out of the garden? Well, all of you would think of this one immediately. It's a water factory. Those clouds on the mountains there in the conservation area are generating this water, which is irrigating that rice. I can't think of a more direct thing. What's this? That's Costa Rica's most valuable crop. That's worth more than any other agricultural crop in Costa Rica, and they know it. So what's this? This is two people happy to stand in the hot sun, spend $500 a day to take a picture of a termite nest. I mean this very literally. They can read. What's that? You say, oh, it's a bird book, the birds of Costa Rica. Uh-uh, that's fertilizer. Okay. I mean this very literally. So what's missing in the national parks all over the world? What's missing is a program in the park called Know Thy Park, conducted by the park itself. We, as scientists, go to wild areas like you go to a restaurant and buy a meal, and you pay at the gate, you go away happy with a full stomach, and how many of you ask, gee, what have I done so that this restaurant is still here 10 years, 20 years, 100 years from now? Nobody. That's why we don't know what's inside these national parks. And can I count on the academic community, me, my guild, to go and find everything in a national park? No way. This has got to be conducted in collaboration with the region, the national, and the international community. And you, by large, this audience, by and large, is the international community. Okay? So what do I mean by Know Thy Park? What I mean is, what's there? What is it? What it does? Where it lives? And how to find it when you want it. What is that? That's the collateral that comes along with a barcode. And the most beautiful thing I've heard this entire week is Suji Van standing up there and saying, you know what, we're going to have a whole bunch more fields. So that when the barcode gets sucked up into this layer that we all live in, it comes with more collateral than just the date of collection, the person who collected it, and the geo-coordinates. Okay? Because that makes that single barcode sequence the pin in a big block of point source, species correctly identified information. So who's going to get this stuff? Well, we call them parataxonomists. The word is derived from paramedic, paralegal, you know, that sort of thing. What do? They go up a ladder, saw the turds on the ground, go up a ladder, find the insect up there, bring it down. That came off the top of the ladder, goes in a plastic bag. They're brought in from the forest. They go in a rearing barn. They're taken care of. They're databased on site. They hang up lights in the forest. But notice a little wrinkle in this. Everybody has a picture of a light trap. The moth is going individually in a little plastic bag. Another one, an individual plastic. Why? So it's not contaminated, so that its barcode is not contaminated with the scales of some other moth. Okay? Then they run through the same process we all know about, processing insects. And they work all over the conservation area. And this is poverty reduction. Rip big. Not only is it direct salaries, direct employment, permanent, long term, but it's intellectually interesting. Try being a guard at a bank with a gun at the front door for more than one day and see how long you last. Okay? Try being a paradoxonomist, you last your whole lifetime. Now, where did the pin come from that I just mentioned? This is very interesting. In 2003, our Victorian way of going at inventory and learning what's inside the parks changed dramatically. Winnie and I were invited to a Cold Spring Harbor event that we weren't speakers in, and we sat there and listened to a whole lot of whole genome, really good genetics kinds of people screaming and yelling at Paul. And Paul, being a bantam rooster, screaming and yelling right back at them. Okay? So this went on all day long. Paul Brightled, about ready to have a heart attack all the time, and about 30 people attacking him, right? And their basic statement was, we don't want another new kid on the block. Okay? This day two, I got so frustrated, I finally stood up. Me, ignorant, I didn't even know what a mitochondrion was. I had to go back and read a basic biology book to find out. I stood up and I said to Paul, I want to hear what you're talking about. I want to see what you're talking about in something that costs the size, it's the size of and cost what my comb costs in my back pocket. And I pulled my comb out and I held it up like this. And he said, you've raised the bar. And I said, that's the only bar that counts. Because what was immediately obvious is that this would give all of society a connection to all those 20 million or whatever the hell number of species there is out there. So I said to him, all right, where did you do your first sequencing so I can grasp this product? I didn't know what DNA was, really, other than that old acronym. This is Paul's butterfly collection. So he said to me, so I use my old butterflies from my closet. Now that, you know, that could be hyperbole, but it's realistic. One could do with that, in fact. So I sent him this box, and I said, Paul, can you tell me how many species are in this box? I'm the only person on the planet who can tell you how many species there are in that box, because I reared all of them from caterpillars. There are 13 species in that box. The very best skipper taxonomist in the world cannot tell you how many there are in that box, and I certainly am not a taxonomist, but I can do it by knowing what they ate as caterpillars, and Paul can do it with the barcode. This is the outcome of that. Whoops, sorry. This is the outcome of that today. Rod Page made this funny little diagram which just shows all the places where there are barcode records in the world. Plastered. And this was a year ago. And this is what Costa Rica looks like. A little heavy bias in there. So when Paul puts up his diagrams of how much has been collected for him here and there, if you look for Costa Rica, often you can't find it at all. He just leaves it off the map. This is Canada's real export product. And I mean this very, very literally. This is, in my opinion, probably the most important thing that Canada's ever contributed to the world. Now, this is on the Smithsonian, Names Are Us, 2003. And this is John Burns, exceedingly good skipper butterfly taxonomist, doing Victorian taxonomy on our skippers. And at that time, we had this butterfly that I'd reared hundreds of. And the caterpillars all looked like this, eating 53 species of food plants. That really puzzled me. Skippers are pretty host specific. And here we had one species eating 53 species in about 12 plant families. And that just didn't make ecological sense. But John pored over these words and he says, you know, I think I can see some differences in the adults a little bit, but I'm not sure, and I'm not sure. I think there's more than one here, but I can't really figure out how to separate them. So right at that time in 2003, I said to this guy, the deer in the headlights, would you think about barcoding a bunch of this skipper butterfly? And he said, blah, 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 sure. And so it looks like a drug deal going down, but this is the this is the bag of Eppendorf tubes with the legs, which then generated that thing, 10 species out of one, which enraged the taxonomic community, okay? But it sure solved an ecological problem. Because every one of those 53 species of food plants dissolved into a little clump, and the 10 species, each one ate one of those little clumps of food plants. There's the butterflies. There are 9 species of butterflies in that box. And you, any school child can tell them apart with their barcodes. Some of them differ by like 3 base pairs. Some differ by maybe 8 base pairs, but it's consistent as you can possibly be. And it matches perfectly with the caterpillars. But I had all these caterpillar pictures, but I couldn't make any sense out of them. But with the barcodes, it makes perfect sense. Now, caterpillars don't come by themselves. They come with parasites. The white things are the cocoons of the parasites. This is one species of parasitic wasp, Apanales leucostigmus. It turns out to have 39 species hidden inside of it in one place. And each one eats a different species of caterpillar. This is the guy who did the morphological side. He had to catch an early greyhound bus back to Ottawa today, so he's not in the audience. He's one of these people that looks at one of these little 2-millimeter long wasps and described the one after the president and says, oh yeah, this is from Malaysia, or this is from Australia. Are you sure this didn't come from Paraguay? Okay. When you start barcoding in serious, large quantities of species that you know about in the field, funny things happen. This butterfly, the queen, is extremely well known throughout the United States and Mexico and Central America, no problem. When we barcoded, it turned out to be 2 in our front yard. And we stared at them and stared at them, and suddenly we noticed that there's a white spot right there on the male androconium. There are ways to tell them apart, but I don't know how many hundreds of butterfly hobbyists and taxonomists have looked at that butterfly and never noticed that white spot. That fly is a parasite of this species of caterpillar. That fly is a parasite of this species of caterpillar. They eat the same food plant, the same place, the same time. They've been called Drinorrhoea for like 100 years. When you barcode them, this one turns out to be 8% different from, this one turns out to be 8% different from that one. You see the width of the dark band right there and the width of the dark band right there? You can tell them apart morphologically once you realize that they're different. This is the Costa Rican version of this species. This is the South American version, and they're all in the same drawer in every museum in the world. And as you can see, they're very brilliant and beautiful and all that kind of stuff. Those are 2 species. Their barcodes are very different. And when you look closely at them, the hind wing, the distance from that fork in the vein to the dark stuff is long. The one over here is extremely short. There are differences. And we find that for 99% of what we find barcode splits in, we can find a way, if you really, really look at the combination of morphology, behavior, microlocation, and morphology, and food plant. Okay? These are biological entities. Now, this is Ian Gall. Again, rest in peace. We used to take every year a box of wasps to the British Museum and ask Ian to identify them for me. He's the worldwide wasp freak. Is what they look like close up. As you can see, these are very distinctive wasps, right? Well, that's the box before barcoding. Normally, it would take Ian an entire day, maybe a day and a half, to identify morphologically all the wasps in that box. And he's the world authority. He described most of them himself. But this time, the little yellow tag says, I pulled a leg off and barcoded it before I gave them to Ian. That's what's left. Me, who knows nothing about wasp taxonomy, could identify all that box except for these, and that turned out to be 11 new undescribed species. Okay. And that's the end of day. We are losing the generation of people who could spend 60 years of their life learning about the taxonomy of one big group of something. And society is not going to support them anymore. The barcode comes just in time. And we have a fair chance of connecting what the barcode can give to us with the 200 years of previous taxonomy roughly and approximately seamlessly if we work diligently at it right now. Now let's go back to the parks. It says Costa Rica ought to biodevelop its national parks. This is the New York Times of Costa Rica, okay? Front page, very in your face, and totally ignored. The National Museum is the national theater of cadavers. The National Park is the national theater of life. We need both. Okay? This is a paratexonomist explaining DNA barcoding to school kids, sixth grade, seventh grade. And this is park staff soaking up the same thing in the teaching program so he can continue to teach kids. You wouldn't believe how many fourth and fifth and sixth graders are around the ACG who could tell you that. DNA, oh yeah, that's the recipe my mom used to make me. This is a paratexonomist who did not finish high school explaining barcoding to the department chairman, a molecular biologist of the University of Costa Rica and of the Chinese government. This is a paratexonomist explaining barcoding and delegging to senior management of Google. And this is them themselves, this is their website in Spanish for the ACG, and you go to the front page and you click on that butterfly and it takes you to a checkerboard of butterflies. Now what's that? Everybody's seen checkerboards of butterflies. The intent of this is just getting started is you're standing somewhere in the conservation area and you see a butterfly and you'd like to know what it is. Notice you don't have a leg or anything like that. You'd like to know what it is. What we want to be able to do is you click a button and it gives you the options that you could choose from on that spot in that conservation area. And that's achieved from identifying previously and photographing previously the butterflies you could see. So these are two of those checkerboards. Then, once you think you know what you do, you go to this thing. And you click on one of these. That's an icon for a species page written by a paratexonomist. Now, I grew up using Klotz Butterfly Guide, Holland's Butterfly Book, DeVries Butterflies of Costa Rica to learn about butterflies. These kids will never see one of those books. They couldn't get one if they wanted one. They're not on the web. And the guy who wrote this species page you just saw there is this person 30 years before. A professional fish predator taken out of that role and now collecting butterflies, hunting caterpillars, taking a leg off, barcoding them, working out what the names are, writing a thing about it, and making it available to the world. There's something in this also, in this biodevelopment, for us, for you know, hardcore scientist kinds of people. It's not just the ordinary people. This very common butterfly, Eugenomia cacaoi, very well known in Central America. But when we barcoded it, turned out to be, well, you can see how you can see the split between 01 and 02 here. You can see how far that is. It's about 6 to 8 base pairs. You know, is that one or is that two? So I go out and get a bunch of these reared and put them in. John organizes them at the Smithsonian in a drawer like this. And he looks very hard at them. Can I tell them apart? And he comes back and he says, no, I can't tell them apart, but could you get more, Dan? So I put out a wanted poster, and in comes boxes full. There they are. We barcode all of these. And Paul screams at me that we're barcoding way too many specimens. And then we map them. One of them is entirely rainforest. One of them is entirely dry forest. And one of them lives on the interface between the two. These red dots out here are local springs and wet spots in the dry forest. We have three species in one place that differ by just a little bit. So we go and get the type from Venezuela. Thank you, Harvard. And they let us take a piece of the abdomen. The abdomen comes off, scrapes some DNA out of the inside, and glue the abdomen back on, and the holotype goes back in a drawer. And we discover that that matches the rainforest one perfectly. So we have two new species and one, and now we know who's who. Here's the situation we're all up against. At one time, the monarch was one species. That's the bottom of this fork in my hand. Over a little time, they start to go up. This is the monarch you know. This is the monarch I know. They get further apart. And they finally get up to there where they're two things. I can tell mine from yours. You can't, but I can by looking at them. Okay? Mine has totally different behavior than yours does. But it's still called Danaus plexippus. What you're seeing is, because of barcodes, I can look at them when they're just starting to split apart. We have committed the huge unconscious error of basing our whole set of biological information on species when they've been long enough far apart to be up there on the tips of these two branches. We don't look at things when they're down here, and down here they're trading genes all the time, but they're starting to be separate. I know, I'm not saying I just discovered this. This is when it becomes obvious as soon as you start barcoding these things. Okay. That pair you just looked at there, out here on the tips of the two branches, that one and that one, you say, hey, those are pretty different. Here's the underside, compare that. They're pretty different from each other. They differ by two base pairs. Selection has worked very hard, very fast, on making two different morphs. And the barcodes simply haven't caught up. But you can tell them apart by those two consistent base pair differences. Now, the bigger Costa Rican society also wants uses, not just a person and a little thing. This is the national park here, the conservation area here, and that is a geothermal drilling site right there. Looks like from the air, and you see there's a white spot which you can't really make out just behind that tower right there. We drop down into that geothermal footprint. There's the white spot, right on the edge, put in right when the site was being excavated. You know what I'm going to show you next. Trap close up, then the content of the trap. That right there is the biomonitoring for the impact of that geothermal site on a piece of original forest. So now we can monitor what's going on the edge of the forest, 50 meters into the forest, and 150 meters inside, because Meredith Hajibabi was loaning me nine of his moist traps. And Paul and Meredith are willing to start barcoding that stuff, and we'll be able to say really exactly what's the impact of dropping a big cookie cutter down on that forest. This is what we're really talking about. We have the first opportunity to have one team on this planet with 8 million people, 8 billion people in it. Because if you put that cheap pocket barcoder, reusable, in the back pocket of every person on the planet, and let them put whatever they feel like putting into it, sure, it's crowdsourcing in a very different than usual sort of way. We will know what the biodiversity of this planet is in spades. Because that's really what we're talking about. I just want to show you three slides at the end. This is the original propaganda for eyeball. Imagine a world in which you can know the name of anything. That's the world that eyeball can build. That was just as true today, that is just as true today as it was then. And it's very simple. But there is one addition. We have to relate that barcode to more than the specimen sitting in a museum. Thank you very much. Took longer than I meant, so you may not have time for questions. I think.
Would you want?
Oh, anybody should give you.
Would you like me?
I'll be happy to answer questions, but I think it's probably best that we don't.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll get it off. Well, let's see if I can get it. Can you see to get it off? I can.
Maybe. There it is.
There we go.
and I'll take your computer. Okay, so our last speaker of this session needs no introduction because I showed you pictures of him earlier. Paul Hebert is the reason we're all here, in a certain sense, you know, the reason we're all here in this room. The father of DNA barcoding and many other things earlier on in his career. But now, as Dan said, he's responsible for inventing Canada's most important product ever. So please join me in thanking Paul Hebert, welcoming Paul Hebert to the stage.
I'm not so often at a loss for words, but today I am, and time is marching. But I really, before I say anything else, I would like to ask all of you to stand and give an ovation. I mean, I go to a symphony or a play, and at the end of it, people leap up to performances that are sometimes quite mediocre. You've heard three people speak from different perspectives with passion. These are the people who are really my superheroes. And Laurence, I'm not sure I know anyone that's as funny as you. I have no idea why you're working in science. You showed how in the early days there was a lot of aggression, intellectual aggression towards barcoding. And you were Barcode Saber. I mean, you were out there supporting this idea in the very early days when it was fragile. And Tom, your presentation tonight was just absolutely what I think we had hoped for. I mean, you know, I've just come to expect deep eloquence from you, having had the chance to work with you on this Canadian Council of Academies mission. So thank you for what you did on that project. But your talk tonight was absolutely inspirational. Daniel, you're amazing. You and Winnie have done something spectacular. When I look at the model DCG, I wonder if we should be spending money on barcoding or on protecting environments, and that's maybe something we can talk about later. But I just would like everyone to stand up and give these three heroes of mine take a bow. Well, 2 years ago when we thought about or given the opportunity to host this conference, we looked forward to it with much anticipation. But when you throw a party, sometimes the guests that you hope might show up don't. You did. You've done us a great honor by traveling to Canada from across the world, from 60 nations, 600 scientists. And when I look out at the group of people in this room, I see a lot of very young academics, the people who are going to lead this discipline into the future. And Tom, you talked about the fact that those of us with a little more time behind us are able to see the movement of technology and the wonderful things that we can do now. But the other thing that comes with having been on the planet a while is you can look back. And when I look back to the icons of my childhood, we had a cottage on Lake Ontario, and I used to go, Dan, while you were hunting, I was hunting clams. Beautiful freshwater clams, unionids. There were 30 species of them in the Great Lakes. They're endangered. They're almost gone. No child growing up in Ontario will pick up a clam because if they do, they may be arrested. It's an endangered species. You're not allowed to touch them anymore. When I was 6 years old, I encountered something that I think may have turned me into a lepidopterist, and that was a mating pair of Cecropia, the largest moths in North America. They were spectacular. I knew there was something special. I put them in a tin can, and I noticed these white things on the wall, and I thought they were feces from the moth. It was the female laying eggs. That's how naive I was. But seeing these immense moths like this, with this wonderful smell, they're no longer here. We inadvertently introduced to Canada, to North America, a taconid fly to try and control the gypsy moth, and unfortunately, it likes other big things. We've lost. No child growing up in Ontario will encounter a Cecropia. When we went in the countryside at our cottage in the evenings, the sound of the whippoorwill were absolutely enchanting. I remember going to sleep and hearing whippoorwills. They're almost gone now. They're extinct in many places of Ontario, of Eastern Canada. They're just hanging on. My family grew up owned property in Eastern Ontario since the early 19th century, and actually my great-grandfather had a farm in the area that the passenger pigeon, it used to be a phenomenally common bird in Ontario. In the 19th century, the last breeding colony was just north of Kingston, very close to my grandfather's farm. And for all I know, he shot them and ate them. Okay, not the last one, but the last one in Canada, because the last one died, I think, in 1913 in the Cincinnati Zoo. That's looking back two generations. The passenger pigeon seems a long time ago. But we're talking the Cecropia moth, the whippoorwill, the unionid clams, and the monarch butterflies that were just everywhere. I've scanned milkweed plants all this summer. I haven't seen a single caterpillar. Wolfgang, you talked about how damn obvious it is when you drive a car down the highway. And that's my sense. We have not been observing nature with anything like the attention to recognize just how bad things are. Butterflies in Canada, you drive along roadsides, and the cabbage white is about the only thing you see. So there's a desperate need for our science, for the young generation of biologists to make use of technology so we're able to observe these changes, document them, because who would be concerned about global warming if we were not monitoring temperatures? I think humanity will get very concerned when we give them the data, so that must be our mission. You've given us a great honor by coming to Guelph. Thank you. I hope you've enjoyed yourself. We certainly have enjoyed hosting you. When we thought about the conference, we decided we wanted to bring in plenary speakers who most would not be from the Barcode community. We invited about 30 individuals, and I'll have to say that without exception, with two exceptions, who had inescapable conflicts, everyone accepted our invitation, and I'll have to say, plenary speakers, thank you so much. You've made this meeting very special. You've broadened our horizons. You've given the Barcode community new perspectives, and of course, we hope that reciprocally, you may have seen the passion in this community and seen the promise, and that you'll be lured to join us in this mission of discovering life on our planet. Some of you were here last Sunday when we had a little bio blitz. We coupled that to the conference so you could see a bit of nature. And I'm happy to report a lot of the data has been analyzed. A paper has been submitted. Biodiversity inventories in high gear. DNA barcoding facilitates a rapid biotic survey of a temperate nature reserve. It'll be published in Biodiversity Data Journal. There are 120 authors from 31 institutions, including 21 students. And that's a product of the 110 people that came out to that BioBlitz. The survey covers 11 phyla, 96 orders, 482 families of animals, plants, fungi, and lichens, nearly 4,000 bins of animals, nearly 500 new to bold. The data was pre-submitted last night. Reviewers have provided comments. It was formally submitted this afternoon. It'll be published on Saturday or Sunday. So it'll be published before you get out of town with any luck. So I have to say we must thank PIMSOF for moving our, you know, the science forward in a rather rapid way. So I'll stop now. We have some very important business to do, but I just want, I think we have one. I had a PowerPoint presentation with 150 slides, but I decided not to use that. Do we have that one thing I wanted to run? Thank you, Victor. While we're waiting for that, I want to thank our sponsors. They made it possible. Maybe you'll remember this the other night. These computer guys, 20 of them. Oh. Anyway, thank you guys for making it great. You're going to do the awards now, I believe? And we're so pleased that so many students joined this meeting in part because of our sponsors, and I think Laurence is going to provide a few more details, and then of course we'll go to our awards.
So I've got a large number of awards to give out. To save time, I think, or perhaps because some people have left, some of them have already been given out. And so I should mention that the training program in DNA barcoding awardees were funded by the Convention on Biological Diversity and the Japan Biodiversity Fund. But they've already received their certificates. So I'll go straight on to the Seabold Travel Award for Research Excellent Awards, and I would like the following people to come to the stage. Bezing, Simeon Bezing, and I apologize in advance for completely mispronouncing your names. Feel free to get your own back at me by mispronouncing mine. Hardy Darudin, M.T. Rengith, J.U. Santhosh Kumar and Sribesh Roy, please come to the stage. So please give these fortunate young fellows a round of applause. Now, all award winners are asked to stay around to the bitter end so we can get a photograph of all of you together.
Oh,
But that will be outside once all of the awards are given. I apologize for the ambiguity there. The next group of awardees is the Biodiversity Institute of Ontario Travel Awards for Research Excellence. This was generously sponsored by the Biodiversity of Institute of Ontario. Where's that? Will the following please come to the stage? Anna Barrera, Arnie Bierman, Justin Bernstein, Heather Braid, Belen Bukowski, Christy Diner, Saren Ochir, Erdeni Ochir, Jennifer Hawkins. Please come to the stage in order, because otherwise it's going to take me half an hour to sort through each of the things to give you. And I hadn't finished. Tyler Cartzinel, Alexander Keller, Kyushi Lee, Christina Mark, Carlos Maurer, Agustina Ojeda, Gregory Niels Puncher, Anais Rai, Rowan Sprague has already got his, but I thought I should mention his name at least, Sergei Turanov, and Lijun Yan. And if you could arrange yourselves maybe from close to me to further away from me, this will get done a heck of a lot quicker. Okay, please give the award winners another round of applause.
Well done.
All right, so let's see if the next large batch of award winners can arrange themselves from left to right in a sequence. The IDRC Travel Award for Excellence in Socioeconomic Applications of DNA Barcoding. This was generously sponsored by the International Development Research Center of Canada. So will the following please come forward, starting here, going over to there. Monica Arakaki, Badrul Amin Bouya, Donna Marie Cawthorne, Juan Diaz, Gracian Gaburo Paneto, Carlos Garcia Robledo, Rocia Ana Gonzalez Vaquero, Ana Marie Gauss, Tana Li Hong, Romana Iftikhar, Sushil K. Jalali, Pablo Di Lavinia, Mauricio Moraes Zenka, David Almondi, Mujikiwis Di Santos, Cynthia Pisoto, Nathaniel Stalin A, and Kuiyo Yesufu. So, is this you?
Not here, Romana? Yeah.
Please give them a round of applause. It gets easier now, because now all the prizes are for individuals. So, the Nobel Prize for Excellence in Polar Research. This is sponsored by the Norwegian Barcode of Life. And the winner is Claire Beat from New Zealand for the presentation entitled Assessing the Distribution and Genetic Diversity of Antarctic Springtails, Calembula. And now I feel really bad about making a joke about a Calembulan in my presentation earlier. So the next few prizes are genome-sponsored prizes, and the conference organizers are grateful to the journal Genome for sponsoring 12 conference prizes, as well as for preparing the open access issue of abstracts. So, let's see, this is getting a bit crowded here. So the Genome Prize for Research Excellence Student Proster Prize, two prizes. The two winners are Justin Bernstein of the USA, for phylogenetic analysis, species identification, and delimitation of New Caledonian geckos and skinks using DNA barcoding. You get this if you catch me some bees and bring them back the next time you go. And Ileana Bistra from the UK, monitoring lake ecosystem health using metabarcoding of environmental DNA, temporal persistence, and ecological relevance. Okay, where are we? Genome Prize for Excellence Student Poster. I just did that one. Okay, Genome Prize for Research Excellence Student Oral Prize. The two winners are Christine and Mark from Estonia, barcoding the Swiss lichens and associated fungal communities using barcoded amplicon 454 pyro sequencing, and Kate Pear from Canada, bypassing the taxonome. Kate, they don't want to know the title of your presentation. It was bypassing the taxonomic impediment in another talk about Calembula, in the neotropical Calembula, to measure changes in diversity and phylogenetic structure. Mea culpa. Now the Genome Prize for Socioeconomic Applications Student Poster Prize. Thomas Royal of Canada for a poster using mini barcodes to investigate the species composition of the late Holocene 3,500 to 200 years before present. And Saloni Malik of India for DNA barcode reference library for Indian medicinal plants of high trade volume. The Genome Prize for Socioeconomic Applications Student Oral Prize. The two winners are Jennifer Hawkins of the UK for using DNA metabarcoding to investigate, somebody crossed out something here, to investigate honey. or the medicinal properties of honey, one of the two. And also Conwar Singh from Malaysia, urban parks as refuges for tropical butterflies. Now we get into the postdoctoral fellows. Genome Prize for Research Excellence for postdoctoral poster prizes. The winners are Valentina Todisco from Austria, two hypotheses on the origin of the Sardinian blue, Pseudophyllodes barbagii, or I think that's the AXY79005 in the new system, Lepidoptera lysaniidae out of Europe or out of Africa, and Christy Diener from Switzerland, the power and promise of environmental DNA for river biodiversity monitoring. Well, there's only one prize in the poster. But the other person, is the other second person here? Pardon? Poster. I read out the oral one. Okay, I've got to go back. Let's try. There's only one in here. Anyway, you get it. I got so used to reading two out at once. There was one prize for a poster and one prize for an oral presentation. So if the other person is here, I do have something for you. She's not here, okay. Now the Genome Prize for Socioeconomic Applications Postdoctoral Poster Prize. There is only one winner. Seiko Saito from Japan, DNA metabarcoding of springtail. Somebody's got it in for me. I had no idea this was happening. I've got a feeling that a new species of entomobride Columbula from Nevada, Nebraska is going to become a citation classic. Okay, so Genome Prize for Socioeconomic Applications, Postdoctoral Oral Prize, Donna Marie Cawthorn from South Africa, harnessing the power of DNA barcoding to detect and deter fish mislabeling in South Africa. Okay. Office of Research Grand Prize for Student Poster Presentation, and these are generously supported by the Office of Research at the University of Guelph. So the poster prize winner is Rocio Gabriela Aguiar Velasco from Mexico for the presentation entitled Species Boundaries, Mitochondrial Integration, and Nuclear Mitochondrial Paralogs in the Neotropical, it's not a Columbulan, ant complex Ectotoma ruidum ectotomini. And the last prize, Office of Research Grand Prize for Student Oral Presentation. The winner is Dorcas M. Legganyani from South Africa. Muthi from the Wild, a survey of bulbous and perennial herbs traded at Faraday Traditional Medicinal Market in Johannesburg, South Africa. Okay, so just a reminder for all the awardees, please stay behind and we'll go outside and get a picture taken of all of you together. Is this the end? Do I have to say the final words? I guess go out and study Columbola.
I just want to do a shout out to the people at BIO who played an absolutely critical role in pulling this together. The conference organizing committee, Mayor Dad, where are you? Sally, where are you? You left the room? Oh, there you are. What? Oh, I'm coming there too. And Bob, where are you? Bob? Come on up. Come on up. And we've got a local support committee. Be quiet just for a minute. I want to invite a few more people up. Suze Beetson, where's Suze? Where is Suze? Jeremy, Sajivan, Brienne, Alex Borisenko, Meg, Dirk, Yevgeny. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. And all the beautiful graphics, I really have to thank Suze for the special job she did on this. It was really a really nice contribution, and Meg has given her life to this, making sure that everyone, things got organized for the conference. Meg, you've done other conferences, but thank you so much. All my colleagues, we couldn't have pulled it together otherwise. Thank you. Please go and party tonight, have fun, and we'll look forward to seeing you at the next conference, which is probably going to be somewhere really exciting. I hope you've enjoyed your time in Canada. We've loved having you here. Thank you.
Oh, you did forget the volunteers.
What? Oh, the volunteers? Oh, and the million.
Hold on.
Sally is going to say one more thing.
Sally. Go ahead. You do. Yeah.
Oh, we want to give a really special thanks to all the wonderful volunteers and to Vanessa for organizing and keeping everybody on track. I heard so many compliments about the team smiling and keeping things running smoothly, and all these folks were volunteering their time, so thank you so much for all your hard work.
Conference services for keeping us fed so well, and media services for the wonderful help. Thank you so much. You've really made everything work. Thank you. My hands are getting sore and I'm getting thirsty. Have fun tonight.